Headline Audio presents, In Their Own Words, Untold Stories of the First World War, by Anthony Richards. Read by Piers Hampton,
Elliot Chapman,
and Katy Sobey.
Introduction. Over the last few decades, the presentation of history to the wider public through museums, publications, and the media has seen an increasing prominence given to eyewitness accounts. This development is particularly obvious when we look at the many and varied interpretations of the First World War. We enjoy learning from the experiences of our ancestors, but while the unit war diaries, military orders, and memoranda in the care of the National Archives portray the official narrative, we need to look elsewhere in order to understand the more human side of conflict. As the events of 1914 to 1918 grow more distant, and surviving participants of the war have gradually disappeared, we have witnessed a much greater reliance on recorded first-hand testimony to tell us exactly what it was like to experience those critical events. While many published memoirs had already appeared in the 1920s and 1930s, which supplied individual recollections, by the 1960s there was still no comprehensive archival source which could provide a broad range of personal evidence. A resurgence of public interest in the Great War had resulted in part from the popularity of the BBC's groundbreaking 1964 documentary series of that name, as well as the recent release by the Public Record Office, PRO, of the official papers concerning the conflict. Mindful of this, and also perhaps of the impending release of Second World War material at the PRO, the then director of the Imperial War Museum, IWM, Dr. Noble Frankland, argued that historians would enjoy a better understanding of these two great events if they could also have ready access to the personal papers kept by actual participants. A new IWM documents section was therefore created in 1969, charged with building up an archive of largely unpublished letters, diaries and memoirs written by service men and women since 1914, as well as civilians during wartime. The few hundred manuscripts that the documents section inherited from the museum's library, which had been collecting unpublished material in a small way since IWM's foundation in 1917, soon grew into an extensive collection. By the time of the centenary of the First World War, the archive embraced the papers of well over 20,000 individuals from Britain and its former empire, and continues to be developed through regular donations and bequests. The strength of IWM's documents collection lies in its breadth of coverage, as it includes the writings of individuals from many varied backgrounds. Indeed, it was one of IWM's founding principles in 1917 that the museum should chronicle the experiences of ordinary people. Modern wars are fought and experienced at different levels, and the personal records of regular men and women are therefore treated equally to those of senior commanders or key decision makers. The correspondence, diaries, and reminiscences in the museum's care contain not only compelling first-hand descriptions of the events witnessed, but also reveal the writer's personal thoughts on the issues raised by war. Those papers relating to the First World War are a particularly essential resource. This book brings together, for the first time, 11 key stories from the collection. From Rosie Neal's patriotic pluck when escaping the enemy's homeland at the outbreak of the conflict, to Gilbert Lathwaite's anxiety at attempting to survive the most intense German assault of the war in March 1918, the personal accounts which form the core of this book are the most direct way in which we can now experience those world-shattering events, through the words of those who were actually there. For that reason, IWM's collection is now one of the most important archives anywhere in the world for those seeking to examine the impact of modern war on British society. Unless another source is cited, the information contained in each chapter is taken directly from the letters, diary, or memoir written by the person in question. Every effort has been made to check historical accuracy, but when an error has been made by the original author, most commonly of a very minor nature and due to the passage of time, this has been noted. The original quotations have, only where necessary, been lightly edited in terms of punctuation and spelling, but overall remain as written by each individual. For those interested to read the original, and in some cases significantly longer accounts, I would encourage you to do so by booking an appointment to visit the IWM Research Room. See iwm.org.uk for further details. Acknowledgements. This has been my first book, and as such, I have relied on a number of people to guide me through the process. Firstly, and where else would I list them, Natasha and Henry, who have been incredibly supportive. I will always be grateful to Liz Bowers, who, in her role as IWM Head of Publications, had faith in me as an author and believed that this book would be a worthwhile project. The current IWM Publications team have also offered much help, with particular recognition going to Caitlin Flynn. I would like to thank Miranda Harrison for her editing and Roger Smither for reading the manuscript. The relatives of those whose accounts form the basis of this book have been extremely kind in allowing me to publish their words, and particular appreciation goes to Margaret Woodley and Kit Hesketh-Harvey, Fanny Hugill and Caroline Ryder, the President and Fellows of Trinity College, Oxford, Dennis Caslin, Felix Gameson, Tim LaGrease, and Sarah West, whose own book, based on Gabrielle West's diaries, is due for publication in 2016. Within the museum, I feel it is only right to single out two particular individuals for special thanks. Peter Hart, punk star, best-selling author, and battlefield guide, shared an enormous amount of advice with me during his rare visits to IWM, where he occasionally works as an oral historian. Peter read through an early draft of the book, and his constructive criticism was greatly appreciated. Any errors remaining are purely my own. I would also like to thank the museum's Queen of Communications, Lucy Donahue, for her much-appreciated encouragement throughout the writing of this book. In fact, the book would almost certainly never have happened in the first place if it wasn't for her nudging me in the right direction, for which I will be eternally thankful, if a little bruised. Finally, I should like to acknowledge two individuals who are sadly no longer with us. My father, Peter Richards, died shortly before I signed the contract for this book, but in one of our final conversations, I was able to confirm that it was definitely happening, which I think pleased him greatly. Should he have had the opportunity to read the book, I think he would have enjoyed it. I hope that the same could be said of Rod Sudderby, my predecessor as head of IWM's documents collection. He worked incredibly hard for many decades in building up and maintaining an archive of immense international importance. And in a small way, this published collection of stories can be seen as a tribute to his dedication. Chapter 1. Rosie. Outbreak of War, August 1914.
The war had begun, and my heart beat then as it had never beaten before.
In the manner of local newspapers the world over, at the beginning of the 20th century, the Edinburgh Evening News was publishing regular reviews of theatrical shows appearing in its district. The edition for the 31st of October 1905 contained a typical example, featuring John Henry Cook's Circus, a place of entertainment that had opened its house for the season last night with a programme which, for all-round excellence and variety, has never been excelled. The circus was known for its various equestrian acts, which included Miss Marie Mears, billed as England's neatest and prettiest exponent of the Newmarket jockey, while Mademoiselle Ada Marjuti, described as the Flexible Venus, more than justified her title by her wondrous performance in this particular line. The most novel feature of the evening was a troupe of Sinhalese performers, who gave an exhibition of native dancing with an accompaniment of wailing melodies, the jingling of an instrument which they carried, and the beating of a barrel drum. Also appearing on the bill were the Five Brewsters, an all-girl act who combined singing, playing, and dancing, and whom the Edinburgh Evening News considered an enjoyable turn. Also known as the Brewster Troupe, or the Royal Brewsters, the girls were led by Catherine Neal, who, under the stage name of Kitty Brewster, had enjoyed success as a Victorian music hall artist. According to family legend, her surrogate father had taught Queen Victoria how to play the banjo. Joining Kitty in the troupe were her younger sister Rosie and three other girls. Regular tours of theatres and music halls, with their entertaining mixture of singing and dancing, had brought considerable success. By the summer of 1914, the troupe was ready to embark on a month-long theatrical tour of Germany, beginning with a date in Hamburg on the 1st of August. For the 22-year-old Rosie and her young friends, a trip which promised to deliver the fun, glamour, and excitement associated with a European jaunt would, in the event, prove disastrous. The five members of the Brewster troop arrived in Hamburg at 6 a.m., early in the bitterly cold Monday morning of the 27th of July. Rosie had suffered seasickness during the voyage, which perhaps had been influenced by the weather. Recent days had been unusually cold, considering that this time of year would normally be considered high summer. Eventually, the ship was towed into the docks, and the girls disembarked, carrying their hand luggage to the custom house, which was no short distance. Katy, benefiting from her position as troop leader, elected to wait for the main luggage to be unloaded from the ship, while Rosie and her friend Edie were sent off to look for accommodation.
We settled our rooms, after asking the landlady if she thought we wanted to buy the house, and returned to the custom house only to find that the luggage had been lost. What consternation there was for a time. All the theatre stuff lost, over £300 worth. What should we do if we couldn't get it before the 1st of August? But needless to say, we did find it, although not for hours. We went all over the town, back again to the ship, and the captain informed us it was not there. So we sent a telegram to England. About midday, we met a man in the street who informed us our luggage was found, for it was still on the ship. We breathed a sigh of relief as we made our way to the docks once more. We arrived at our rooms having done all the work, feeling quite pleased with ourselves for the remainder of that day.
The following day was a more sedate one, as the girls recovered from their voyage and occupied themselves with pleasant thoughts, enjoying their new surroundings and planning their stay in Hamburg. In the evening, Rosie accompanied Katy and Edie for a walk, during which they called at a cafe for a drink.
While sitting there, all the newspaper boys began to shout at once, "England and Germany!" Not being able to stand this any longer, we asked the waiter what it all meant. He, either being too upset or not able to understand my good German, could tell us nothing, so we came to our own conclusion that there was going to be a war, at which we gave a hearty laugh, strolled home, had our supper, and turned into bed feeling quite easy about the war.
It is perhaps forgivable that the girls showed little concern for the likelihood of a war occurring between Britain and Germany. Those who had been keeping a closer eye on political and military current affairs, however, might have been more prepared for a violent outcome to the summer's crisis. The political situation across Europe had been thrown into turmoil by the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the Austrian throne, shot during an official visit to the Bosnian capital Sarajevo on Sunday the 28th of June. The gunman was one Gavrilo Princip, a member of the secret Serbian society known as the Black Hand, which had been formed to promote the political and racial unification of Serbia with the Slav populations of Bosnia, Austria-Hungary, and other neighbouring territories. Their ultimate goal was the formation of a new Yugoslavian state. The Austro-Hungarian Empire had controversially annexed Bosnia and Herzegovina in 1908, taking over its significant number of Slavic inhabitants, and in the process seriously damaging relations with Serbia and its close ally, the Russian Empire. Austria-Hungary blamed the Serbian government for supporting the assassination of Franz Ferdinand, but the strong links between Serbia and Russia meant that any threat to the smaller country would likely lead to larger repercussions. Austria therefore fell back on support from her strongest ally, Germany. Russia maintained an informal alliance with France, as did Britain. This European balance of power had been regarded as a way to guarantee peace and avoid any major conflict within Central Europe, despite the constant troubles present in the Balkans. It is perhaps ironic, therefore, that in the subsequent July crisis, these beneficial ties would fast become the chains that would drag each and every one of the chief European powers into a major war. The Austrian demand for revenge on Serbia coincided with a degree of opportunism on behalf of the other nations involved, but particularly in the case of Germany. The German Empire was already building up its military and naval force to exert power, but the instability caused by the assassination suddenly presented a new opportunity. As international tensions developed, basic preparations for war by all countries began across Europe, with military strategies revised and mobilization of armies planned in order to make a clear statement to one's rivals. Even before the events of Sarajevo, a war in Europe had been considered likely by many commentators. Although Serbia suggested international arbitration to resolve the matter, Austria-Hungary severed diplomatic communications and declared war on Serbia on Tuesday, the 28th of July. The following day, Germany requested a guarantee of British neutrality in the event of war, which was refused by the Foreign Secretary, Sir Edward Grey. Russia ordered full mobilization on the 31st of July, as did Austria and Turkey, with Germany, France, and Belgium following suit on Saturday, the 1st of August. For Rosie and her friends, however, the only event to arouse excitement in their minds on this particular Saturday would most likely have been their imminent performance to entertain the theatre-going public of Hamburg. There was a distinct lack of information available to non-German speakers, as the local newspaper sellers were no longer supplying English papers. Post from England was not being delivered either, and so the girls had stopped writing home. They intended to return in a few days at any rate, and would have ample opportunity to catch up with world events once their tour was over.
That same morning, August the 1st, our landlady informed us her nephew was coming and would want our room, mine and Edie's. We didn't live at the same house as Kitty and the two other girls, as there was no room, so we were obliged to sleep out. She told us that Kitty's landlady had another room now, and it would be much nicer for us all to be in the same house. She would help us move our clothes and baskets. We thought her a very nice woman, and I tell you we were jolly sorry to leave. But it is only now that we know that she was a wicked old bounder. She had heard the rumours of the war and wouldn't have us in her house as we were English. Anyway, Kit's landlady took us in and was jolly pleased to.
Evening arrived, and the girls began to get ready for their show. Unfortunately, their excitement and anticipation would be spoiled by the first inklings of war reaching out to touch their lives.
When night came round, we set off extra light-hearted to work, but, alas, there we sat and waited. Presently, one man came in who inquired if there wasn't going to be a show. The manager had to tell him that he didn't think so, as he was the only audience that had made an appearance, and it was then 10 o'clock. So there we sat far into the night talking of the war. We returned home feeling very downhearted, as the war was the cause of no audience and no show. That night, the last ship sailed for home, but we didn't know it.
The following day was Sunday, the 2nd of August. Unbeknown to the girls, German troops were marching into Russian Poland, Luxembourg, and France. The girls discussed what they should do and came to the realization that even if the theatre were to open, the audience were unlikely to accept a troupe of English girls performing for them. They therefore looked at the possibility of finishing their tour early and discovered that no ships were leaving for England. Dutifully returning to the theatre that evening, they found the building locked up and decided that the only thing to do would be to report to the British consulate first thing in the morning.
So when Monday came round, we went, and to our great surprise there were hundreds of English people in that office. Eventually, we were able to speak to the consul, and we told our troubles, as hundreds had done that same morning. We told him that we had come over here to work a month at the theatre, but now the place was closed and the director gone to war. We had our return tickets, but the boat wouldn't be going out until Wednesday. Did he think that after all it would go when the time came, or had they really been stopped as we had heard? He appeared to be very sorry for us, and, saying something about his God, asked us if we had any money. Kitty told him yes, she had a little, but if we were going to be shut in here for long, it would soon go, and there was no possible means of getting any now that the mails were stopped. He told her to go at once to the shipping offices and see if there wasn't a boat going, as he thought that one line was running boats to Grimsby for a day or two. By this time, I had found a lady friend who wanted to get back too. She was awfully upset, taking things more to heart than we were, saying that she was quite alone, and Kitty and I alone, we took her along with us to this shipping office the consul had told us about. It was called the Rover. I might tell you we were afraid to ask a German the way, so we were looking about for a man that looked English. At last we thought we spotted one, but alas, he turned out to be a Spaniard and could tell us absolutely nothing. He was a stranger like ourselves. At last, in despair, our lady friend asked a postman who evidently couldn't understand his own language. Had I myself asked the way, I could have forgiven him when he said he didn't understand, but our lady friend spoke German like a native. At last, he thought he had struck it. He thought we were looking for the British consul, as every Englishman was doing that day, so he tried to send us there. But no thanks, we had just left. While we were still arguing the point with him, a real-life German, seeing that we were in sad troubles, came and spoke in good English, asking what he could do for us. We soon told him, then he took us into his shop, which was quite handy, and found the address of the place we wanted. Having got this, we thanked him, and started off to look for it once more. Our lady friend was all excitement, and proved to us a bit of a nuisance, but at the same time a huge joke. Kit and I could have found the place quite easy, but that woman, if she asked once, she asked 20 times, and it was only 5 minutes' walk. I shall never forget her, and that day, no matter how long I live to be. Well, we arrived at this shipping office at last, and only to find it packed, hundreds of people buying tickets for England. Our lady friend bought a ticket and was going to sail on Tuesday. She told us there would also be another boat on Wednesday, and tried so hard to persuade us to get tickets to go also, but we told her we had return tickets in another line, and we must go there to see if they had a ship going. When we got to the top of the street again, she left us, and I can speak for us both when I tell you we were mighty pleased to see the end of her. Now we strolled off to our own shipping office, the Great Eastern. On arriving there, we asked when the next ship would be sailing, but he simply said in plain English, "There is no ship. You must walk." Needless to say, this gentleman was German. The worry of war began to tell on Kit, and she asked him if he took her for Jesus Christ, that she could walk on the sea. Here I had a good laugh, and I was not the only one, for there was a young English fellow in the office who it greatly amused.
After all the excitement, Rosie and Kitty returned home to their lodgings and shared a simple dinner. This was their first meal at home, as until now they had enjoyed meals in local restaurants, but the diminishing funds at their disposal were beginning to become a problem.
That night, we thought things over. We must get back to England, is what we were saying, so poor old Kit was counting out her gold to see how much she had, and she came to the conclusion that she did not have enough to pay our 5 fares. Our Great Eastern tickets were no use on the Rover line. Once again came forth the great question. What were we going to do? Something must be done. At last, Kit said, "I have plenty of things I could pawn, but I don't know the signs of a pawn shop here." "We must find out, so we will ask the landlady." Well, we asked her, and the poor old soul looked at us as though we were things of the past and gave us an address to go to. Then we went to bed after a most eventful day, thinking that in the morning we should go to the pawn shop.
Tuesday, the 4th of August, dawned, a day that would be remembered as a turning point in history. Germany had declared war on Belgium and immediately commenced an invasion, with the aim of sweeping down into France. Britain mobilized its army and issued an ultimatum to Germany, stating that unless guarantees of Belgian neutrality were received by 11 p.m. GMT that evening, war would be declared between Britain and Germany. For Rosie and her sister, however, their immediate concerns were over a much more personal issue. Any worries over the international situation were veiled by sadness over the immediate need to raise money by selling their belongings.
Kit had got out her jewels to pawn, and we all had a last look at them. I, for one, shed a silent tear, for I never thought we should have to do this. Kit reminded me that we had better go to the shipping office first, to make sure that they were still going, and we didn't want to pawn our things unless it was absolutely necessary. When we arrived there, the office was still full. People were still buying tickets. At last, after being pushed here and there by people half mad with anxiety, we were able to speak with a man over the counter. We asked him if there was a ship running tomorrow, Wednesday, for England. He looked at us as though we were soft, and said something. Goodness only knows what. I suppose we frightened him a little. Anyway, he called another man to help him. This one informed us that there would be no boat leaving Hamburg on Wednesday, and that the last boat for England was leaving in 2 hours. Kit and I just gave a knowing glance at one another, when the same voice almost frightened us, saying, "You must write to your king. There is nothing else for you to do. Perhaps he will help you out of your trouble." Really, I felt I could hit him. Fancy telling us to write to our king. But after my temper had cooled down a bit, I took it as a huge joke. Now we were in the street again. A terrible thing, this. No ships to get to England, no work to do, and no money to live on. At least I say no money. We had a little, and if we were very careful, it would last some time. So now we had to be extra careful, as we were shut in Hamburg and goodness knows how long for. We returned home and told this sad news to the girls, who by this time had begun to take things as a matter of course. There it was. We were shut in, and we must make the best of it. That evening, after tea, I strolled into the landlady's kitchen and picked up her paper, which had just arrived. I looked at it quick. I could not believe my eyes, and yet it must be true, I thought. Yes, England had declared war with Germany. At last it had come. How could I go and tell those poor girls this horrible news, and yet it must be done? I knew it would be a terrible shock, although we had been waiting for it for 2 or 3 days then. As I thought, it was a shock, but not quite as bad as I had imagined. They were brave girls. I suppose this was their British pluck. What our feelings were for an hour or so, I must leave you to guess. That night, none of us slept peacefully. About midnight, there was a terrible noise in the street. There was a special paper. What had happened, I did not know, but the word England rattled through the street. I thought for sure the war had begun, and my heart beat then as it had never beaten before.
To most British people, the German invasion of Belgian neutrality was a clear reason to go to war. The previous day had been a bank holiday in Britain, and for many, the last such public holiday before Christmas was the usual combination of day trips out and various festivities, although in numerous cases any enjoyment and relaxation was marred by the cries of the news vendors, especially in London, announcing the increasingly bleak political situation in Europe. While there were certainly crowds caught up by patriotic fever in London and the larger towns following the formal declaration of war, far more characteristic was a feeling of quiet uncertainty about the situation. Many felt that the circumstance in which Britain found itself was an inevitable consequence of Germany's political and military manoeuvrings, and that a short war centred around the Balkans, in the manner of the limited fighting in South Africa, in which Britain had been involved at the turn of the century, was likely to commence.
On Wednesday, the 5th of August, Kit and I decided to go to the consuls at once, and although we both felt that the dear old Union Jack would be taken down and the British consul gone, we said nothing of it to each other. It was only when we turned the corner by the docks and saw no Union Jack that we realised that we were alone in the enemy's camp, and no one to help us. But it was not so exactly, for in my excitement I ran up those stairs, mindless of the policemen with their rifles who were guarding the place, and to my surprise saw a notice on the door, "Call at the American Consul's," and it had the address underneath. This we copied in haste, and off we set once more. After some considerable time we found it, packed with English and Americans, as all the other places had been during the last 2 days. After waiting about an hour, the consul made a speech, saying that he had just had a wire from Berlin. The Kaiser wasn't allowing any foreigners to leave the country until the mobilisation was over, which would last about a fortnight. A fortnight? It seemed a lifetime to look forward to. But we could only hope for the best.
The next morning was Thursday the 6th of August, and the girls revisited the American consulate to see if there was any news. The first person they saw was the English lady who had bought the ticket to sail for England 2 days before.
She told us that the boat had been taken up the river, only to be brought back by a German cruiser. They were then kept prisoner in the harbour for 36 hours. When we got a little further into the building, we saw an English clergyman, and looking a little closer, saw him with two young men that looked something like sailors, but they had very few clothes on. One had on his engine room outfit, which consists of a pair of blue pants and a smock, while the other had just shirt and pants. I felt sorry for these two poor fellows, and wondered how they came there like that. But the clergyman told us that they had come into port knowing nothing whatsoever of the war, and had run onto the mines, and the ship had been blown to pieces. These two, by sheer luck, had come out uninjured, and the majority of their mates lay in the hospital.
Trips to the American consulate were now a daily occurrence, in the hopes that each new day would bring with it the chance of boarding a ship for home.
This morning we saw a lady who inquired how long we had been there, what our business was, and what money we had. At this, Kit said about £3. Then she asked us how much it cost us a day to live, so Kit told her. Then she thought for a while. I suppose she was counting it up, and said, "Oh, your £3 will last you quite a long time." We wished the lady good morning and went. When we were outside and quite safe, we couldn't help but smile. We had never been asked such questions before, but we had never been to war before either.
Another port of call was the local police station, to which the girls were ordered to report on the 7th of August. At the sight of five young women armed with their passports, the policemen in the office were dismissive and told them to return the following day, handing them forms to complete so that they could be registered as aliens.
Next day we went the same round, first to the police station, and he looked at our papers, which he had given us the day before to fill up, and gave them us back again and told us to come in 8 days' time. Then he said, "When do you intend to leave Germany?" Kit's reply was, "When you think fit to let us go. We are not staying here for our own pleasure." Then he said, "All right, come back in 8 days' time if you have not gone." As a general rule, English people get looked on with respect. But just at present it is the reverse, and we began to get afraid to go anywhere that the people were not English. Just at present there is only one place where you can find anybody English, and that is the American consuls.
Monday the 10th of August arrived, exactly a fortnight since the day that the Brewsters had arrived at Hamburg docks and lost their luggage.
What a lot has happened since then. If only we had foretold this, we should not have worried over our luggage being on the ship, but would have simply turned back to join it. Some people would say, everything happens for the best, but in this case, one would hardly think so. Well, on this Monday morning, we went down to the consuls, not a bit light-hearted, for by this time we were thinking what a useless trot it was. We were about 20 yards from the office when we met two young men. That they were English, anyone could see. As we came nearer, one of them spoke. "There is good news for you today. You are English, of course. The consul has told us to tell any English people we met to be ready, for at any moment they may be able to leave, but we have to call round this afternoon when he will be able to tell something more definite." You can't imagine our surprise. We could hardly believe it. I saw a tear spring to poor old Kit's eyes, but it was for joy. I could have done the same, but thought I had better not. How delighted the girls were when we told them this good news, I must leave you to guess. In the afternoon, we went round, as we had been told. There was a young man on the door, and he wasn't letting anyone in this afternoon. As we came up, he inquired what we wanted. Kit told him she only came to see if there was any news. He said, "You are English. Yes, there is very good news for you. Most likely you will be able to leave in 4 days, but you must come in the morning." We were jolly pleased to hear this from the office, and returned home with very light hearts. The next morning came round, and off we sailed once more, only to learn that our clergyman had been taken as a spy, and stood a very good chance of getting shot. After waiting around there all day, we learned nothing regarding our going home, but we heard no end of blood-curdling yarns from the other prisoners. One man had come from Berlin on a military train, and when eating time came he was asked if he was a soldier. He said yes, and took coffee and rolls with the others. When we arrived the next morning, Wednesday the 12th of August, We were informed we must have an American passport. They had evidently got something in their minds. Either they were going to smuggle us on the American man-of-war, Tennessee, that was coming in a few days to take the Americans away, or they were going to try and protect us by saying we were Americans. We had to fill up a big sheet of paper, had to tell even the colour of our eyes, shape of nose and mouth, and that was as far as we got that day. That wasn't the passport, we just had to swear to that little lot. The fourth day, Friday the 14th of August, had come round. We wondered this morning if we should hear anything definite about going. On arriving at the office, our hearts sank. There was a huge notice. Up till now, no possible way for British subjects to leave Germany. One man tried to cheer us and told us we might be here for years. That day, we sold our return tickets, so when we do come home, we shall come at the expense of the British government, and the sooner it is, the better for us, for we are nothing more or less than prisoners. True, we are allowed to walk about the streets, but we are not allowed to speak unless we speak German, and as we can't do that, we have to say nothing, and people look at us as though we have done something terrible. One night, a man chased Edie and I with a stick and told everyone else to do the same. I tell you, we have never run so fast for a long time. I expect every minute for one of us to be taken for a spy.
Several weeks passed, and August turned into September. Rosie and her friends continued to live frugally, making regular trips to the American consulate in the hope that an opportunity to reach home would materialize. They were ordered to report every day to the police station. The one day they failed to do so, a summons was received at their lodgings, ensuring continued compliance. The day finally came when the Brewsters' money ran out. But fortunately, they were able to claim from the British Relief Fund, drawing just sufficient to keep us. This amounted to 5 marks, or 5 shillings per day. This was particularly fortunate with regard to their accommodation, as their German landlady had already threatened to throw them out on the street if her rent money was not forthcoming. The fine late summer weather was a welcome addition to their otherwise unfortunate situation, until the American consulate followed up on its advice to facilitate a return home.
One fine morning we became Americans. Yes, it is true, we paid 5 and 4 for a sheet of paper with a big red seal. We were Americans, and nobody could say otherwise. But I never knew until then that one could change their nationality so quickly. Many times our hopes were raised, and so many times they were crushed. About every 10 days there was a notice for ladies to get prepared for the journey, as they might be able to go any moment. When we turned up next morning, the notice was turned to the wall.
Their attempts to obtain a sea passage home having failed, the only opportunity that remained appeared to be to try to cross the border between Germany and the Netherlands. Their time spent at the American consulate meant that Rosie had mixed with many others in a similar situation, and despite their new status as neutral Americans, making an eventual return home more likely, the subject of a speedier but covert method of escape was raised.
While down there every morning, we met several people who turned out to be fairly good friends. In fact, I should say very good friends. 2 were English doctors, and there were 3 Scotchmen. These people tried their very hardest to help us out, but all in vain. At last, we could stand the suspense no longer, so these 5 men decided to draw lots to see which of them was to take this terrible journey on his own. It was a terrible risk, we all knew, but something had to be done. If one could get through, then we could all go. Well, it fell on one of the doctors, Dr. P. It was very sad when we said goodbye to him, for we were pretty sure he would be held up at the frontier and taken prisoner. Days passed, and there came no news of him, until at last we heard through the American consul that he and lots of others had been taken prisoner, and were now digging in the fields with a bayonet only a few yards behind. They wrote asking the consul for money, as the prison food was not sufficient to keep them together, as all they had was black bread and coffee. Poor P. He did that all for us, but we could not help him out.
On Wednesday the 23rd of September, the girls learned that some women travellers were being allowed to pass the frontier, although a certain amount of bribery of the German border police seemed to be required as well as the continued ruse of posing as neutral American travellers. Receiving the money for their travel expenses from the British Relief Fund, they were finally able to make a start on their attempt to get home.
On Friday afternoon, 25th of September, we came to collect the money for the journey and told our Scotch friends to get home quickly and write letters that we could take them to England for them. How pleased those boys were. They were going to get news to their friends at last. This was a great risk, for if those letters were found on us, we also should go digging the fields with Dr. P. But our British pluck came forward once more. We were quite prepared to take them. Leave it to the Brewsters. They would hide them somewhere. We promised to meet those four boys at 6 o'clock and collect the letters. When we arrived there, instead of being four, there were about 24. They had all told one another. Anyway, we didn't mind. The more the merrier. We took them all, and only too pleased to do so. And some who had only just discovered we were going brought letters to the station on Saturday morning. The morning we left, our old landlady shed a few tears. Whether she was really sorry or not, I'm sure I can't say myself. I think the money was worrying her, but that mattered little to us now. We were leaving their country, and that was all we cared. On arriving at the station, we found several friends to see us off. One of our Scotch boys couldn't come, as he had sent his boots to be mended. It was jolly hard luck on those boys. They had only come over for a holiday, and naturally only had one pair of boots. They couldn't come out when it rained, either, as they only had flannel suits and straw hats. Everything went all right until we arrived at Osnabrück. Here we had to change and wait about 4 hours. While waiting here, a convoy of wounded came into the station. Poor boys. Although they were Germans, one couldn't help but feel sorry for them. Some were wounded in the arm. We saw the nurses take them something to drink. On leaving that station, one of our young ladies jumped a flight of stone steps and dislocated her ankle. I really thought the girl had broken her leg, and I half carried and half dragged her to the other train, which was due out any moment. What my thoughts were, perhaps I had better not say, but I can assure you I wished the Germans and the war somewhere. We were very fortunate in arriving at the train in time, and after us all telling the girl off for being clumsy, thought it time to look after the foot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.